249, two stanzas, 318, 319. Avajje vajjadassino vajjecha vajjadassino miccha ditthi samadana satta gacchanti duggatin vajjan ca vajjato nyatva avajjan ca avajjato samma ditthi samadana satta gacchanti suggatin avajje vajja dasino vajje cha vajja dasino miccha ditthi samadana satta gacchanti duggatin vajjan ca vajjato nyatva avajjan ca avajjato samma ditthi samadana satta gacchanti suggatin beings who imagine fault in the faultless and perceive no wrong in what is wrong embrace false views and go to a woeful state. Beings knowing wrong as wrong and what is right as right, embrace right views and go to a blissful state. The Buddha had to recite this stanza because of few children. This religious competition was very strong even during the Buddha's time in India. The followers of other religion teach their children not to support, not to respect, not to cooperate with the other religious groups, or especially priests or the monks who are belong to some other religions. So what happened? It is mentioned the children of some heretics were advised by their teacher not to salute the bhikkhus and not to visit the monastery, not to visit the temple also, advise the children. One day, as they were playing with the children of the Buddha's followers, they felt thirsty, those children. So, the son of a lay follower was asked to get some water from the monastery. This child mentioned that matter to the Buddha, who advised him to bring all the children to the monastery. After they had quenched their thirst, the Buddha preached the Dhamma to them, and they became his followers. The parents, hearing of their conversion, were at first displeased. Later, they all came to the Buddha and became his followers. Thereupon, the Buddha uttered these verses. This is happening today. So one day I have told you this in one of my discourses. Children were taught by their parents and elders not to show even smiling face to the followers of other religion, because they are enemies. Regard them as enemies because they do not follow our religion. And they are going against the will or the wish of our God. You should not develop your friendship. You should not associate with them, and you should not show your smiling face to them. I have seen this on many occasions. According to my experience in this country, when I show my smiling face to some people, they show their sour face to me. They never acknowledge that. And some people never look at our face second times, because they were taught it is wrong. So can you imagine the human mentality, how they were trained to become slaves to religion, without allowing human beings to use their human mind or common sense or understanding. They narrow or they blindfold people's mind by applying their religious attitude or belief. So unhealthy religious atmosphere or unhealthy religious competition exists because of this attitude. Otherwise, what is the purpose of a religion? For what purpose? To train people to live as real human beings with understanding, cooperation, extending kindness, sympathy. If these good qualities are not there, then where is religion? Where is religious way of life? People can say, oh, we believe in God, we pray and worship. If we do not know how to regard others as real human beings, how can we cultivate our religious way of life? Chinese philosophers very strongly emphasized their views. Develop your relationship to human beings. rather than developing your relationship to God. When you develop your relationship towards human beings, all of us can live peacefully as good friends, supporting each other. But when we develop our relationship only toward God, by disregarding human beings, the life can become very miserable. There is a deep meaning in this Chinese philosophy. So we cannot practice any religion by discriminating, disregarding, or blaming, ridiculing, accusing the followers of all the other religions. We cannot justify the uniqueness of our religion if we maintain such belief or ideas. And this attitude, Buddhist could manage to maintain for more than 2,500 years all over the world. You cannot point out a single incident during this period in any part of the world. The Buddhist have created violence or bloodshed to convert or to introduce Buddhism to others. Never had such thing. But when we read the history of various other religions, you can understand. They had to declare war, not only violence, because of religion. So this is recorded in the golden letters in the world history, the Buddhist attitude of patience, tolerance, and understanding. Here this incident. The children were taught by the parents not to go to the temple, not to pay respect to other religious people. But when they were playing with the Buddhist children, then when they said they are thirsty, they were playing near the temple. So they were invited to go to the temple to have water to drink. The Buddha invited all of them and given them water to drink. After that, they feel very happy, advised them. So they wanted to follow the Buddha. And the parents came to know that they wanted to follow the Buddha. At the beginning, they were not very happy for changing their religious way of life. Later, when the parents also associated with the Buddha, they were convinced, they too decided to follow the Buddha. Because of this incident, the Buddha had to give this sermon. Avajje vajja dassino, vajje cha vajja dassino. Beings who imagine fault in the faultless and perceive no wrong in what is wrong, embrace false views and go to a woeful state. Satta gacchanti duggatim. Duggati means unfortunate state. Woeful state. Those who accept, those who believe wrong belief, wrong ideas, wrong attitude, wrong way of doing things, wrong way of talking as good things. Try to justify nothing wrong. Then the Buddha says, those who hold such views, such beliefs, sattāgacchanti duggatiṃ, later their lives become very miserable. Not only hereafter, even within this lifetime, people do not respect them. People do not support them. People do not welcome them. And after that, after their death, because of the wrong views that they had, it is impossible for them to have a better rebirth. Wrong ideas. Now, what is happening in this world today? Life is going on changing. Ideas are changing. Education is changing. Then, morals, ethics, manners, customs, way of life, all these things are also going on changing. Shame and fear. Before religions come into existence, shame and fear maintain human dignity, govern the whole humanity to live as cultured living beings. Shame, by thinking as human beings, it is disgraceful for us to behave like animals or by maintaining some sort of cruel or wicked and immoral practices which are condemned by the public. That is called shame. Because of that, they maintain some sort of principles, good qualities, without violating certain behavior accepted by the public. There are two kinds of good and bad behavior. Man-made ones and natural ones. Man-made morals or ethics are changeable from time to time, country to country, according to their way of life and education, because they introduce those manners, traditions, customs, according to their convenience at that time. In the parliament, from time to time, they introduce, enforce new laws. Later, they amend or they withdraw because they come to know these things are not suitable according to these circumstances. These are called man-made laws. All are changeable. Now let us refer to the Buddha. He has introduced so many Vinaya rules, principles, precepts for the monks and the nuns and the devotees to observe, to practice. Within his lifetime, he had to amend many precepts that he has introduced. The Buddha is a very understanding religious teacher. That is why we always say there are no religious laws, religious commandment, religious punishment in Buddhism. When the disciples come and complain, the difficulty of observing certain religious manners and traditions and customs and way of life, then the Buddha gives the permission to amend. The one particular precept, the Buddha has amended several times. When the complaint and difficulties come from the disciple, because they are not belong to immoral or wicked or harmful group. They are mere traditions, customs and way of life. They are changeable. Now monks' way of life and nuns' way of life, when you study, the Buddha had to introduce all these things by considering the way of life in India 2,500 years ago. According to the circumstances and situations, environment, way of life of that country, to work with the same people. Supposing if the Buddha lived 2,500 years, how many amendments, how many changes, how many new principles he introduced from time to time. Use your common sense, then you can understand. But still we are struggling with those principles that he introduced 2,500 years ago, according to Indian tradition and Indian customs and Indian way of life. But many people take these things as very important Vinaya rules. If Buddha existed today, you won't be able to find out any of those things, but introduce new principles according to the modern society and modern way of life, modern education. I have told you several times, I think you can remember, many of those precepts are manners. Eat how they eat their food, how they use their robe, how they walk, how they sleep and lie down, how they sit down. All these are precepts. I told you, after eating, the Buddha says, don't lick the hand. That is Indian custom. Even today, many Indians say, without this, there's no taste, you know. They cannot give up that. Then after eating, they had to do that. The Buddha said, you must maintain your dignity. He wanted to introduce a holy order of the monks who maintain human dignity. That is why he said, don't talk keeping the food in your mouth. You must swallow your food, then talk. If possible, not to talk while eating, because his advice was to concentrate on food. What we eat, why we eat. Disciples approached the meditation master and asked, can you tell me what are the methods that you practice for your meditation? Then he told, I practice only two methods for my meditation. Eating and sleeping. Then he asked, how can it be that? Yes, I am not joking. When I eat, I do not eat like you. Always I concentrate what I eat. Why do I want to eat? My concentration is with the food. I take the food as an object for my meditation. Again, he has advised the monks to recite, not to recite, just to concentrate. Patisankhayo niso chivarang patisevami yavadeva gacchaya. I am taking this food not to develop my muscles and sinews, not to build up my body, not to develop energy to enjoy worldly life. Deva davaya namadaya namandranaya. I do not take this food to beautify my body, to have nice complexions, to build up my body. Yava deva imasa kayasa titiya. I take this food just to sustain, maintain my physical body. Brahmacharyanugrahaya, to support my noble way of life. Without food, I cannot continue my noble way of life. That is meditation, that is concentration. So every time when we eat, you also can do that, no harm at all. Of course, you like beauty and complexion and you cannot get rid of this thing. It doesn't matter. But it is very important to concentrate on. Again, the robe. Jivarang patisevami. I use this robe not to decorate my body, but to get rid of heat, cold, wind, flies, mosquitoes, and cover my nakedness. Only for that purpose, I use this piece of cloth. All these are concentration. So that is why that monk said, I take only eating and sleeping as object for my meditation. When I go to sleep, not like you, I never go on creating all sorts of imaginations. I never allow external object to enter into my body, into my mind. I go on concentrating, either radiating my loving kindness or concentrating or inhaling, exhaling, then you can guard your mind without allowing any kind of evil thought to enter into your mind. You can protect your mind. Then easily you can go to sleep because no disturbances in the mind. you don't arouse the brain cells. Brain cells get the chance to settle down, calm. Then easily you can sleep. Then subconscious mind also does not disturb by projecting all sorts of things which are deposited in the subconscious mind, because the mind is calm. Mind is not ready to receive. The receptive power is closed. Then can avoid all sorts of dreams. So, these are very meaningful, practical, a real Buddhist way of life, actually speaking. So when you go to bed, you go on thinking all sort of things. Then whole night turning this way and that way and that way, cannot sleep, then get up, take one sleeping tablet and go to bed. If you know how to guard your mind without allowing all those rubbish enter into your mind, you can sleep peacefully. That is what that meditation master said, I take only these two things. We can take anything as an object for our meditation. I told you, a girl, young girl who disturbed a meditation master in the temple, because her house was very close to the temple. The monks liked to meditate in the evening. That girl, every evening, starts singing. The monks has no right to go and ask her to stop. She's doing in her own house. Now this has become real nuisance to this monk. What to do now? He cannot meditate. Then he thought, why not I concentrate on that singing? Take that singing, the sound vibration, as an object without allowing emotion to entertain, to admire, but only the sound vibration. Now, he is not concentrating about singing. The vibration, the word come out from the mouth, he concentrated as an object. He attained the sainthood. Can you believe that? Not only that, if anybody come and started to scold you by using all the dirty, vulgar, wicked words, if your mind is dualer, you can concentrate on the word without developing anger, jealousy, grudge and enmity and irritation. Listen very carefully. That scolding can become the meditation. I think all of you know how Socrates meditated. His wife is a very hot-tempered lady. Every day come and scold that poor man. He is a philosopher, deep thinker. She come and start to scold. Then he listened very carefully. When she stopped her scolding, then he said, actually I feel very happy because your way of talking is improving now. Formerly you made grammatical mistake, wrong pronunciations. Now you are improving. Go ahead. That is concentration. See, any bad thing you can take as an object if your mind is strong enough. Without developing anger or enmity or grudge or ill will, take it as an object. The Buddha was invited, a Brahmin. Brahmins are very angry with the Buddha. The Buddha was invited for dana. He accepted, went to his house. As soon as he entered into the house, this Brahmin started to scold the Buddha by using all the dirty words. With smiling face, the Buddha was listening. Allow him to end. When no more word in his vocabulary, then the Buddha, finish your talk? Yes. Then he said, when you invite one of your friends or relatives for a lunch, if that person did not turn up, what are you going to do with the food that you prepare? Then he said, yes, I enjoy with my family, I don't throw away. In that case, all the dirty words, what you used just now, so I am not going to accept. Then you have to accept. If I am not ready to accept, then you have to take back. This is the way how wise people act. Sariputta, the chief disciples of the Buddha, scolded by another Brahmin, shouting and shouting and shouting. Sariputta was sitting like a statue. He was very angry. Then he shouted, did you hear what I told you? No. You didn't hear that I scolded you? Did you scold me? I didn't hear. Because he was not concentrating for what he was talking. His mind is not working with that man's scolding. We can divert our mind toward something else. Then we won't get it. So we had to train the mind to divert our mind, so that we can avoid so many problems. This is the technique. In fact, the Buddhist method for us to learn to avoid so many problems and worries and enmity and anger and violence. So here the Buddha says, if people can understand that these things are wrong, by using their common sense and understanding, then they had to accept. They should not try to justify. There is nothing wrong. And the biggest problem is, we know that we are wrong. We know we have done the mistake. But because of our egoism, very strong egoism, never allow our mind to admit, to accept, or to apologize. Then the troubles to aggravate the situation. So one or two words are more than enough for us to settle the very big problems. I am very sorry. If it is a very big mistake, I apologize. You never lose anything by saying, by behaving like that. And that person become your friend, not enemy. When you say, I am very sorry, if not, I apologize. But egoism is very strong. This egoism is so strong, we carry this up to the last stage when we develop our saintly life. You know that. Sotapanna, Sakadagami, Anagami, Arahanta, there are four stages. After that, attain nirvanic bliss. No more problems. But we cannot reach, we cannot climb without unloading, without dropping certain heavy mental defilement that we uphold in our mind. Too heavy, we cannot climb. So the first stage, we had to drop three. Second stage, we had to reduce two more, but cannot completely eradicate because they are very heavy. We can reduce 50%, then attain the second stage. To attain the third stage, we had to reduce the 50% that still we are holding. What are those two things? Sensual pleasure and hatred. These two things are very, very strong. First we reduce 50% and the third stage completely drop. Not crazy for sensual pleasure, no more hatred or ill will. Mind is free. Now one more stage, highest one, Arahant. Still we maintain five more, altogether 10. 10 fetters. 10 impediment or mental defilement. So we have dropped 5, still holding 5. Ruparaga, Aruparaga, Mana, Uddhaccha, Avijja. These 5. Ruparaga. People know through meditation, when they develop their mind, reduce their lot of mental defilement, they can go to Brahma world. Rebirth can take place in Brahma world. It's called fine material world. There they experience less burden of the physical body and spend for a long period peaceful life, but it is impermanent, not permanent, not remain forever, changeable. We had to drop that belief also. Then there is another stage, Aruparaga. Life exists without any physical burden. It's very nice. Now, because of this body, every day we had to suffer, we had to work, we had to feed, we had to look after, we had to wash and clean and beautify and decorate. How many things are there? But when this physical body is not there, the life exists without this, how nice. We have three kinds of mana, pride. What are those three? I am higher than, superior. I am superior to so and so. That is called one kind of man, higher. Not I am, we. Our race, our religion, our complexion, whatever we take as superiority complex, it is mana, it is pride. The second stage is, I am equal to them. They think they are big shot, but I am also equal to them. That is also mana, pride. They are not higher than me. Try to maintain some sort of superiority complex. We are all equal. They are not higher. And the last one is, you know, some people say, well, what to do? We are poor people, they are big shot, and that is also some sort of pride. They got money, they got everything, but we are poor people. Anyway, we also must live. That the mentality maintains some sort of pride. These are the three kinds of pride. So we carry this up to the last stage. That egoism and pride. Then only we have to drop it. The last, next one is Uddhacha, restlessness that people cannot understand. Why restlessness remains in the mind? There are two reasons. Certain mistakes, bad things that we have committed in early part of our life, create this restlessness in the mind. The memory. If not, certain deeds that person have committed during the previous birth remains as karmic energy in the subconscious mind, projects. So, we do not know we have restlessness. No reason. That is the reason. Without our knowledge, our memory or previous experience creates some disturbances in the mind. By developing our conviction, determination, devotion, confidence, we had to overcome it. After that, no more restlessness, calm. Then last one, avidya. Avijja still remain. Because this circle of existence, wheel of existence, start from avijja, ignorance, and goes one round, 12, link, come back to the same area in the end. So that ignorance still functioning in the mind. So however educated
wise, clever, intelligent we are, ignorance is still there. And that is the last one. We had to drop from our mind to attain arahantama. Otherwise, no arahantama. So this ignorance we had to drop by analyzing Four Noble Truths. There's no another method. When the realizations appear in the mind about the Four Noble Truths, that ignorance also then attain sainthood, arahanthood. Now you can understand how our life exists and what sort of thoughts that we maintain in our mind, how we try to justify so many mistakes, so many evil things, so many immoral things that we have committed. So what the Buddha tried to say, you should not try to justify. When you come to know that these things are wrong, you have to admit, try your best to avoid. That understanding is very important. I told you these things are wrong means the things generally accepted by everybody, they are universally accepted, universal fact. Example, honesty. You break your honesty, bluffing or swindling. Then you try to justify. I had to do this because of this and that. But those excuses are not important. You cannot justify that. Because it is accepted universally without any controversy. Everybody knows that it is wrong. These kind of principles. As I mentioned, the man-made law, from time to time, they are changeable. Sometimes by breaking man-made law, you cannot create bad karma. But you will be punished by the society or by the government. Example, police, army, navy, air force, they have certain principles, law, introduced by the government. So they had to uphold those principles. If they violate or break some of those principles, they will be punished by the government, but difficult to say that they have committed bad karma if they are not immoral or cruel or wicked or harmful. Now you can understand the point. That is what they are called man-made law. They are changeable. Then another government come, they will change the constitution. I can give in Nepal, missionary groups started to build hospitals, orphanages, schools, all over the country. Then the government allowed them to complete the building. When they have completed the building, the parliament amended a law, existing law. What is that? No one can convert Nepali into another religion. It is a law enforced by the parliament. So what happened? Those missionaries who started many of those projects slowly give up and withdraw. Because their main purpose is conversion. Also, the parliament can change the law. So it is not the man-made law. Here the Buddha always used the universal law. There is no such law given by the Buddha. You cannot say this is Buddha's law. He has no law. He was not a lawgiver. He said, I understood the Dhamma. I realized the truth. Truth is common to everybody. So I explained the truth or the Dhamma. I am also not free from this Dharma. The Buddha also not free. What is Dharma? Natural phenomena, natural occurrences. How many problems, how many troubles, calamities, sufferings, disturbances he had to face. Such an intelligent, compassionate, kind-hearted, honest, religious teacher. The nature is such that disturbances in this world, sufferings, pains, sicknesses, old age, problems. These are the universal law. No one is free. So if we struggle to overcome them, stop them, we are not wise. Our duty is to understand this. Our life is subjected. This is Dhammata. This is the nature of existence. If we want to exist, if we want to live, if we want to enjoy, then we have to pay the price for that. Not free of charge. We occupy this body. Life occupied this body, this house, without paying house rent. We do not pay the rent, but we are paying the rent in terms of pain, ache, suffering, old age. This is the tax we are paying. So why do you grumble for that? You must understand, you cannot stay freely without paying the rent. Then nothing to worry, nothing to grumble. That is Dharmata, that is nature. the Buddha, he also occupied this body. Then when he was 8 years old, he showed his body to his disciples. Wrinkles all over the body. But today when you build images of the Buddha, the dying moment also look like a 35 years old Buddha. You know, we make the images. He's 8 years old. And he said, look at my body. Wrinkles everywhere. You have seen me 30 to 40 years ago. Complexion, golden color. So where is that color now? That is impermanency. That is dharmata. The Buddha's body also not free from this. Then what about you? This is the practical teacher. Then the sicknesses. How many sicknesses I had to suffer? I cannot stop them because I am holding this physical body. When I drop this physical body, then I will be free from all these things. That is called attaining nirvana. We drop all these things. Then no sicknesses, old age and death and worries and problems. So, but how many people can understand this? So, avajje vajja dassino, vajje chachar dassino, mitchaditti samadana satta gacchanti dukkati. So if they hold such views, there's nothing wrong. The excuse is this. When you say this is wrong, you are doing wrong thing. People, what do they say? Everybody is doing. Everybody is doing. That is the excuse. So if everybody is doing, that means good. Can you justify that? Everybody is doing. It's good. Must understand what the Buddha says. Dandha bahu. Majority here in this world are foolish people. Majority. Only very few people are intelligent and understanding people. So if many people are doing those things, that means they are foolish people. So how can you justify that? Everybody is doing, therefore I also do. So you won't be free from the bad effect just because others are also doing. Because you are individually responsible for your life. You do not follow others. You cannot follow others. Therefore, you must know what is right and what is wrong. So if you hold such wrong views, wrong beliefs, wrong ideas, the Buddha says, Vichaditti samadana satta gacchanti duggati. Such people, after their death, definitely their life become very miserable, very unfortunate life. Because of the wrong views, wrong ideas. The wrong views that we maintain in our mind create the bad effect again in the next life. You cannot understand this. Then I can give an example. You plant a very sour mango seed. Very sour. After that, the tree grows, produce mangoes. When you eat, you can see very sour. But earlier, when you eat that seed, can you get the taste of sour? Sour taste in the seed? No. But when the tree was growing, when you eat, can you get that sour taste? No. Only fruits. Then only the taste. But that taste was there in the seed. That seed is just like our mind. It is in our mind. So that mind is the seed. Planted again, that means another life come into existence. And the sour taste again. Sour taste again appears. At the same time, you plant a very sweet mango seed. After that, when they grow, the fruits bloom, very sweet taste. How that seed carry the taste? So many things support it. Cosmic energies, water, soil, heat, so many things support it. So in the same manner, when our mental energy with those ingredients departed from here and we planted somewhere else, the sour taste and sweetness we can find there when that one grow, that next life grow. I think you can remember I mentioned, when we die, our germs, virus, bacteria also die. After burial and cremation, no more germs or bacteria. We cannot carry for the next life. But the germs we maintain in the mind, just like sweetness of that mango or the sour taste of that mango, carry forward to the next life. If you maintain your anger, your hatred, your ill will, in your mind, they are germs. In the next life, that you condition or created, the same ingredients are there. That is how we maintain all our good thoughts and all our bad thoughts, life after life. When you think, you can understand. It's not difficult. Then, second line. Vajyancha vajyato nyatva avajyancha avajyato sammaditti samadana satta gacchanti sugati. If you can understand that this is wrong, this is right. Accepted by everybody. No controversy. Irrespective of race or religion, everybody accept. Then, those who maintain such belief, satta gacchanti sugati. Duggati means unfortunate. Sukgati means fortunate. Then the life becomes very fortunate, very pleasurable, very contented, very peaceful life because of such clear vision, views, mentality that we maintain in our mind. So the life cannot become miserable if we die one day with such pure mind, without holding such wrong belief, but by knowing, holding that this is right and this is wrong, then pave the way. Sugati means fortunate state, either good human beings or devas or brahmas, to lead a peaceful life, not to become unfortunate human beings or blind or mad or crippled or dumb or stupid, or not to become animals or devils or ghosts or spirits. We will be free from all those unfortunate states because we are cultivating life after life, developing step by step to see the goal, the aim of our life. We are moving here and there, not knowing the aim of our life. The Buddha tried to point out, this is the aim of our life. Then we never get into trouble. We never suffer again. We never complain again. Life becomes meaningful, peaceful. So one day we will be able to see the end of all our suffering physically and mentally. Thank you very much.